One of our students, Ankit Jain, secured one of the highest marks in FSCM in the recent July CA final exam. After the results were declared, in less than a week's time, he was offered the role of an equity research analyst. Recently, I've had the opportunity to interview him, and we discussed about his FSCM exam strategy, the challenges he faced while preparing for the exam, how he got selected as an equity research analyst, and finally, we also briefly discussed about the career opportunities for CAs in core finance field. I hope you'll find our discussion useful.
Congratulations, Ankit, on securing one of the highest marks in FSCM in July attempt. 83 marks is very good score. And congratulations on getting selected as equity research analyst. I mean, the results were out just last Monday, and within 1 week, you were able to get a job, and that too in core finance. So that's a stupendous feat. So congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thanks.
Okay. So, Ankit, why don't you just introduce yourself?
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir, and good morning to all. My name is Ankit Jain, and I'm from Chennai. I cleared both groups of CA final in July 2021 examinations and secured high 83 marks in FSCM. So I'll be basically sharing few tips and strategies on how to go about the subject and how to tackle it.
What we will do is, first we'll discuss about the FSCM paper. That is, why did you choose FSCM? And what was your strategy for this paper and the classes? And then what we will do is we'll discuss about your interview, that is how you got selected as an equity research analyst, and what are the career opportunities available for those who choose the FSCM paper.
Sure, sir. Sure.
So, Ankit, why did you choose FSCM, like of all the electives that are there? So, why FSCM?
Actually, there were quite a few reasons for me to select my elective. The first thing was my core interest in the subject, FSCM, basically capital markets. And also my G1 SFM was my strongest subject, which I didn't want to let it go. And also for the fact that the MCQs were relatively very simple when compared to other subjects. And also one thing I noticed in the previous pattern trend of the papers was that the case studies were asked from a particular chapter only, but as it is now, it is not the case anymore. They asked from many chapters also.
Multiple chapters, so, yeah.
Yeah, so then it was quite like they were asked from a single chapter. It will be easy for me to search through the answers in the exam and not waste much of a time. And the second reason was my love for passion and finance and for capital markets, since my IPCC race is like never ending. It's like growing a lot. And I also wanted to make a finance as a long-time career. So I think these were a few reasons which made me go.
Okay, so the main reason is your love and passion towards the subject, finance, and you want to make a career in finance. That's a good thing. And many fresh chartered accountants nowadays, more and more people want to get into finance. So that's very good to hear. And there are some practical reasons also, as you were saying. Yeah. All right, so once you selected FSCM, or once you decided to choose FSCM, did you receive any suggestions from the other final students? Was there any peer pressure, like where they're saying, like, why did you choose this particular elective instead of something else?
So after taking FSCM as an elective, I initially felt very alone in terms of the subject. So I was like secluded in one part of the corner of the room, like this guy doesn't belong in this room, because FSCM, one of those subjects which is not spoken much about. So that was the case in my study group also. And also you don't find many people in the exam hall writing FSCM. So you be the one person in the entire hall or even the entire room. So that was the case.
Let me ask you one thing. Of all the people you know, who secured the highest in the elective?
I think it was me only, sir.
That's good to hear. Like, even though you might have felt secluded earlier, but you have something to show for. So that's good. Okay, continue, please.
So sometimes I just felt intimidated by the number of RMs and ECO students who have opted for this particular elective. So, but I think I made one thing sure in my mind that I have to work my way through this for the selective. There was not much guidance available for this elective in the beginning case. But there was no peer pressure as such. But since I had a strong mindset that I have to make my work through this for this subject. So, I thought I can do it since I had a lot of interest and since I had a few practical experience.
Yes. So yeah, passion trumps peer pressure, I believe. So how do you feel now? Like, anyways, at that point of time, you might have felt a bit intimidated and all. So how do you feel right now?
Now,
do you think you made the right choice?
Yes, sir. Yes, I feel that even I had spoken to my parents of changing elective in between. But after writing the exam paper, I feel that I made the best decision of my life.
Okay, that's good to hear. So what challenges you face, like once you chose FSCM as the elective, so what challenges you face while preparing for the examination?
So the first challenge in itself is when compared to other electives, FSCM is quite a voluminous subject. Since there are two modules, module A consists of 17 chapters and module B consists of 5 regulations. And completing the entire 17 chapters with conceptual clarity itself was a major challenge in the beginning. Like most subjects are confined to one specific kind of a boundary. But when it comes to FSCM, it is a very comprehensive subject. You just can't limit yourself in the ocean of finance, like only this is restricted to your curriculum or this is not restricted to your curriculum. So that was the case with FSCM. And also the fact that ICI can ask any question, like they can ask a simple...
That's true.
They can ask a big case even from single liner concept in study material was just an added to the wound. And also for the fact that ICI modules were not updated initially, there were a few contradictions among the module also. And also there were the concepts were not explained in very detail. They were given one-liner concepts here and there. So all this piled up and I just had to introspect my decision whether I have made the decision, right decision or not. But luckily...
I'll speak about it. So one thing is, yes, the book is not very comprehensive. The ICI study material is not very comprehensive. I don't know like how they compile these various chapters and all. But if you go through some of the chapters, what happens is whatever statement they made in one chapter, there's a contradiction in another. In some cases, there's a contradiction in the same chapter also. And some of the concepts, as you were saying, like they were just one-liners. They were explained properly. So their context was not provided. So that is one of the major problems that the students face with this subject, FSCM. That is true. But when it comes to the volume of the chapter, volume of the subject and all, one thing I want to say is like many students actually chose risk management because of the volume of the subject, like the number of pages or number of chapters. And I tell the students like, see, these are not the parameters that you should base your decision on. What you should do is, like, if you want to make a career in one particular stream, you have to choose accordingly. Okay. So people were thinking, like, risk management, I mean, they have to spend very less number of hours and all. And we have seen recently what happened. Like, people were coming out of the exam hall crying and
crying
all. They were
with
sobbing.
Tears,
So that's not the way to choose a elective. And let me tell you, it doesn't mean that FSCM is easy and risk management is difficult. The next attempt, it could be reverse also. It all comes down to your interest, your personal interest, in which stream you want to make a career in, and what subject you're comfortable with. Some people are not comfortable with finance, which means they should leave out FSCM and risk management. Whereas some people are not comfortable with taxation, which means they have to opt out of international taxation. I mean, these are my two cents about selection of the elective. So, Ankit, how did you come to know about our classes and what made you choose our classes for FSCM?
So basically, sir, I saw an introduction video on YouTube with Vishal Bhattat, sir. So as I had taken IDT from him, then I had some ray of hope that, okay, something is there for us, for FSCM students to know, at least get a feel of the subject. Then after watching your demo classes on YouTube and also seeing your demo notes, also the demo notes which you had displayed on YouTube, and also your video on how to solve the Jan 21 suggested answers, your approach of solving the paper made me like, this is what exactly I was looking for such a long time. So then immediately I just ringed up to Catalyst CA and I started inquiring about the classes in May 21. Which is when the second lockdown was in place. So, but your team did a great effort to get the physical books and help me start my preparation. But since the exam was postponed from May to July, only then I was able to take classes for FSCM. Otherwise, I wouldn't have taken class for FSCM. It wasn't.
Because we also launched pretty late, actually. The thing is, like, we announced in February, but by the time the classes were ready, it was in March. So there wasn't much of time for the May examination, but the exam got postponed. And I think many students actually joined in the last 2 months also. For example, Ankit, you are Ankit, right?
Mm-hmm.
So Anant, who scored 75 marks, he took it in the last 2 weeks.
Oh.
I mean, I don't suggest anyone to take classes in the last 2 weeks. Or in the last 1 month, the thing is, like, he was happy, he was able to focus, and he was able to get a good score. So yeah, and I think you were also a bit skeptical to join, because, like, from what I heard from Rajesh, who's our front office executive, so you had many questions and all, and he was answering. I think he has lots of patience. Rajesh has lots of patience, so he was answering all those queries. I can understand, like, we started this recently, I mean, the digital classes, though I was taking face-to-face classes for CA and CFA. So this digital classes is a new thing. So you must have concerns about that. What do you say, like?
Yes, sir. Basically, since I saw only few videos on the YouTube, I just wanted to know how they are going to deliver the classes in this lockdown situation. Because if the main reason why I wanted to join is, first, your classes, and second, your notes. Since it's an open book examination, I can carry those notes with me in the exam hall, so for me to refer on any concept or any thing. So I just want to make sure that I get the notes before I, you know, go for exams. Until that time, I wasn't sure how many days exam will be get postponed, because the schedule was not announced that early. They announced it a little later. So I just wanted to make sure that I complete all my classes, I get the notes so that I can appear for the exam with 100%.
Okay, that's good. So how was your experience with our classes?
The first thing I noticed about the classes was they were very systematically structured. Like, also the sequence in which the classes were recorded and provided to us were highly on how the concept is being builded from one chapter to another chapter to reach the final level. And even the classes were made into small concept videos on each topic, which made it very easy for us during the last revision days, as to we can watch on the particular concept which are not that much, which we have a doubt upon. And also, the end of each video, you had made a revision summary video, which helped us a lot for the last day revision, the 1.5 day revision. And also, more than just teaching the concept, your classes were linked practically to. And also, the classes involved numericals wherever possible. And also, I think you spoke, you also shared your experience of what you gained in your investment banking experience, which was just an icing on the cake and was so much fun to learn, like getting to know of what practically the industry is all about. So it was the best part of it. And also, your classes were very point and precise, so which saved us a lot of time for us to, you know, move on to the next chapter and understand the concept in the first place. Overall, it was an amazing learning experience with beautiful learnings and some real life examples, like even Lord Balaji borrowed money from Kubera. That was one of your nuggets from I think banking chapter where people borrow money for.
I think it's treasury.
Yeah. So all these were like, they automatically put a smile on your face, even you are going through a very tedious watching classes at the fag end of the exams.
Okay, that's good to hear. I just want to ask about one thing, because, like, many students who call us, the main concern they have is with the duration of the classes, because, like, the main classes, apart from the case study discussion videos and also the revision classes, case study discussion videos, they go for 7 to 8 hours, I believe. When we focus on the main classes, these 35 hours, so many students have a concern about it. Like, they feel that is 35 hours enough, 35 hours sufficient. The thing is, like, when I took this face-to-face class before recording these classes, so it came to around 120, 125 hours. Okay. However, because of the format in which we recorded the classes, because of the animation and all, so what happened is, like, we were able to bring it down to 35 hours, because our intention is not to waste a CA final student's time. We know how precious a CA final student's time is. So that is our intention. So what did you feel about it? Like, because many students have this concern, is 35 hours sufficient? So how do you feel about it?
So initially, when I was looking at the description of the classes, even I was shocked to see it will be completed in 35 to 40 hours. But the way the classes were structured and the sequence was arranged, I never knew that when this 35 to 40 hours got completed. It was like it just went on in a jiffy note, but yet giving you the conceptual clarity and the content and giving you the skills for you to write the entire 100 marks paper in 4 hours. So I think it was just kind of a magic trick, I don't know, which this 30 to 40, 35 hours, 40 hours played in my entire CA final journey.
Okay, that's good to hear. So now let's get to your preparation strategy. Like, of course, I told the students how you should approach the paper, how you should approach the case studies and all. But you should be having your, every individual has his or her own strategy. So what was your strategy for this paper?
So since I took the class at the very back end of the exams, so my plan was to at least give one reading of the subject, like at least one watch once your classes fully, conceptually, and make notes then and there in the study material or your catalyst notes, and link them to practical examples and case scenarios like you had done in your classes. Like there was one concept of CDOs for which I watched an entire movie called The Big Short to get a feel of it. Just to have how things are practically working in the market. And then I Googled about a few of the hot trending topics in finance, which were that point of time.
CDOs were not actually properly explained. Even the chapter credit debit is not accurate actually in the ICA material. Chapter should have been named structured finance products, I don't know why they named it as credit debit. So it's good to hear that you try to learn practical concepts, and also you must have learned the concepts in a fun way, because Big Short is actually a very fun movie.
Very fun movie, yes, sir.
Yeah.
So doing this made me gain more confidence on the subject, and it gave me a control on the subject as such. Like I had some sort of control on the entire 17 chapters I was doing, and also the 5 regulations. So for theory chapters, I made sure that I have a conceptual understanding of all the topics which I discussed in detail. And for practical chapters like mutual fund, factoring, leasing, working capital, banking, finance, project finance, I made sure that I solved your catalyst sums first. Then I made sure that I get the old PM questions done, and also few of the SFM problems which were interrelated. So doing this was a complete package. I could idea of I could get of the subject of what questions I can expect in the examination part, and also the regulations. I just gave one formal reading just to understand of what the entire thing was, as it's mainly compliance oriented only.
You just need to know what the theme of a particular regulation is. You don't need to know each and everything. That is why actually many students are worried about FSCM also, because they think that Part B, they have to go through all of that. They don't need to actually go through all of that.
Yes, just have to give a simple reading, and it's not necessary for you to memorize anything. Just remember the concepts and understand the concepts well for you to be have more command over the subject when you write the exams.
Yes.
So after that, I prepared a detailed index of headings and keywords and sorted them out alphabetically. And I backtested it using the past RMS papers, like past RTPs, MTs, and other stanzas, whether my index paper is really working or not. Is it effective to be used in the examination part also? So I think it's better for, if you prepare an index, it's better for you to backtest it also before the exam, so that you understand where your index paper is lacking as such.
Okay. So this is all what you have done to ensure that you get a good score in it.
Yes, sir.
That's good. And what about your exam day preparation? When I say exam day strategy, I'm talking about the 1.5 days that you have before the examination. So what was your strategy for those 1.5 days?
So during my 1.5 days, I had given one full day for DT. Because it is I gave one full day for DT because it's very voluminous, as everybody knows.
Yes, I can understand. When I was giving my exam also DT, I wasn't even able to revise half the subject before the examination.
Correct. So I only started FSA on the second half of the previous day to the exam day. What I basically did was I just based upon my concepts, and if I had any doubt, I revisited your revision lectures, the audio. Which I had which I had with me. Then I used the index. I started solving RMS using my index sheet to get a feel of it in the examination. Since in the examination, we are going to solve one week questions. We are not going to go and study there anything new. So yes. Just to get a hang of it, I started solving questions at home itself, whether I will be able to write the answers in 4 hours. So I did solve few past papers and a few RTPs and MTPs. And also I made a separate index on which topics were asked in the RMS part. So suppose, for example, one RTP has asked like 5 questions. So I just noted down which concept the questions were asked in the RTP, like first is mutual fund, second is derivatives, or third is leasing. So which were very helpful in those first 15 minutes of the examination. So first, during the first 15 minutes, I just got the question paper. I immediately ran through the theory questions, theory part of the questions. I didn't study the case study. I didn't study the MCQs because I know they are largely manageable by any extent. So I just quickly ran through the theory questions.
So and yeah, just to clarify to those who are watching. So now you're discussing about the 15 minutes before the examination. Like once you start the examination, you'll have 4 hours. But before that, you have 15 minutes. So you're talking about what you did during those 15 minutes. Am I right?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay. So in these 15 minutes, your focus was on the descriptive questions, not on the MCQs.
MCQs.
So you're
yes,
going sir. Through the descriptive questions. That's a very good strategy because MCQs, more or less, students will be able to answer. So that's not a big deal. But the main issue is with the descriptive questions. And I think in the previous examinations also, many students were complaining about the difficulty level of the descriptive questions and not the
only. MCQs.
So
yes,
it's a very good strategy that you follow. Yeah, please continue with that.
So the index which I made for the RMS topics which I asked, so I immediately noted down the topic, the question or the chapter from which the question is being asked in the question paper itself. So okay. I started searching of which topic has been asked in the past papers and just flipping the pages to get whether it's a direct question or not. So I think out of the 5 questions, 2 questions were direct, 2 case studies were entirely direct questions. So I noted down the RMS paper and the question paper itself for later reference so that I can save time while writing. I don't have to go through all the pages again to get the answers for me. So after going through the paper, I just made one thing sure that the buyback question was not within my cup of tea because I have to go through the regulation once and I have to understand the case study, then have to deal with numbers. So dealing with yes. numbers in such a pressurized situation is what I mostly avoid of. So basically, okay. I did the theory question first, the first mutual fund question and the factoring question. They were straight sort of a case study type, theoretical type. Then I went for the leasing question, which was a similar question in your past RTP or MTP and the case study digest. So I was okay. sure of for these first 3 questions to get me a break even or at least to target exemption. And the remaining 1 question of whatever time I had, I just managed to solve it. But going again, I couldn't solve entire 100 marks. I just left 10 marks due to shortage of time. But still, out of that, I could score 83. It's still, I believe it's a very good thing for me to happen.
Yeah, actually, I forgot to mention that. So Ankit was able to attempt only 90 marks. He wasn't able to complete the paper, but out of 90 scoring 83, that's very, very good score. Like, can you discuss about your interview experience? Like once you got your results, what happened, how you got selected and all?
Actually, I was took away by surprise that getting a formal interview from CRISIL to join as an equity research analyst. So the interview was a very nice experience, like from starting first round to director's round. Then I have been selected for an equity analyst role for the management training. So actually, FSM played a big part in taking this role because there are a few concepts which we have already learned in investment banking chapter as a buy-side analyst and as a research analyst. So yes. For interview process also, I studied these materials just to have basic idea about how these things work in real life example. So I think this is what helped me largely to crack the interview and also to get placed at CRISIL.
So how was the interview experience? You enjoyed it?
Yes, it was a very pleasant experience. Like I was able to answer like most of the questions which were from financial reporting and SFM and also a few of the puzzle questions, and I wasn't panicked, which would have been otherwise if I hadn't known the subject or hadn't command on the subject. So
I think it's
it was
rather difficult for someone who hasn't chosen FSCM to get
FSCM
into this
too.
role, because
yes.
of course, I mean, equity research, it's been discussed in the investment banking chapter, and
chapter.
To some extent in the credit rating chapter also, because in CRISIL is a credit rating
organization. Credit agency. Yes, exactly.
And if you remember in credit rating chapter, we discussed that one of the functions of a credit rating agency is to provide information services. Also.
Services. Yes.
And that's exactly what CRISIL is doing with respect to this equity research analyst role. And
yes.
I believe it is going to be on the buy side, right? Like your role.
Yes. Yes.
So
sir.
That is nothing but part of the information services.
Information services only.
That credit rating agencies provide. So that's good to hear. And also in the investment banking chapter, though the equity research was actually mentioned, I don't think it was discussed in detail.
In detail.
They haven't
yes,
discussed about the buy side and sell side.
On the sell side.
However, I think I explained to you what a buy side analyst does and what a sell side
analyst
does. Because like I have experience working as a sell side analyst. So I brought in my experience, and it's good to know that it helped someone in getting. I mean, I'm not saying that you have been selected because of that, but if it helps somehow, it's good to hear that. So, what do you think an equity research analyst is supposed to do? Like, for the sake of our audience who are watching this, so can you just discuss it?
Yes, sir. So the basically my job description roles involves about preparing valuation models. Basically
okay.
of the companies and for the traders who are trading in UK, Canada and other parts of the globe, and also
okay.
to build a valuation model on the earnings session whenever they
okay.
have a earnings session on the results sessions, results week, and also
yes.
to update the models of any adjustments are being to be made specifically for a company in a specific industry or working in a specific
sector. Yeah.
Yes. So basically the role is about give an idea of how the business is growing and how the business is doing in the economy, and also looking at the macroeconomic factors that affects the business.
Okay. So for those who are wondering what an equity research analyst does, so normally an equity research analyst is assigned a specific sector, or sometimes a subject, or sometimes even a couple of sectors also. So what the analyst is supposed to do is they have to understand what that particular sector is, what are the dynamics of that sector is, what are the various regulations that apply to that particular sector and to the companies in that sector. They have to get the data from various sources, and they have to understand the financial statements, what is the financial standing of a particular company is, and they have to convert all of this into financial models. As he was saying, the valuation, they have to do this valuation models, they have to create valuation models, run some numbers, and find out what is the value of that company is and what is the per share value of that company is. And based on any events that are happening, etc., if there is a change in the management, or if there is a change in the legislation, or if the central bank has made some changes in its monetary policy, based on that, the analyst has to keep track of how it may affect the share price of this company, and accordingly they have to advise their clients. So this is what an equity research analyst does. However, the thing is, like buy side analyst and sell side analyst, there are some differences in what they do. And one more thing is, in sell side, what happens is the role is not very structured. A sell side analyst has to wear multiple hats sometimes, whereas in buy side, the role is more structured. They are going to do maybe only one type of job instead of doing multiple jobs. As he was saying, as Ankit was saying, so he is going to get into valuation. That is what he's going to focus on. Whereas if it's on sell side, the person may have to do valuation, the person may have to write reports, and the person may have to sometimes even address the concerns or grievances of the clients also. So that is the difference. Anyway, Sankit, so what do you think are the opportunities for CAs in finance, like particularly fresher CAs? Because normally when we talk about CAs, people think about audit, or people think about taxation, or to some extent they think about reporting. So what do you think about opportunities for fresher CAs in finance, in core finance?
So I think the career opportunities in finance field for a particularly CA is very much underrated, sir, because there's a huge job market and also a huge scope out there. which is not tapped by a lot of chartered accountants, particularly the budding chartered accountants.
Yes.
So, and moreover, after the COVID outbreak, where all business had come to a halt, stock market, the capital markets were the only business which was running, as both NSE and BSE were not shut even for a single working day. So this in itself is a big indication that there is a lot of scope to be explored in this field, in the capital markets in the coming future. And also a CA can provide a lot of consultancy or advisory services by just passing a few exams of NISM and getting a SEBI registration. Or if at all he wants to work in a corporate, like a big investment banking firm or a big universal bank, which offers both banking and investment banking services. I think there's a lot of division in M&A where you can be a buy-side analyst or a sell-side analyst, as you just explained right now, or also be a part of a boutique firms, like small private firms which offer these services, like private equity and valuations.
Yes.
So I think there's a huge market, a huge huge chunk of this part is being still unexplored of.
Yes. So the thing is, like, in the past one decade or so, because of this outsourcing of these finance activities to India, because earlier it used to be only IT. Of course, IT continues even to this day, but in the past decade or so, many US-based investment banks or global investment banks, they started their captive units in India, and there are lots of job opportunities. And though the thing is, like, there are lots of jobs for MBAs, there are certain jobs which only a CA can do. For example, if we consider equity research, so an MBA is not good with accounting, and an MBA cannot read the financial statements as good as a chartered accountant. And they may not understand concepts like deferred taxation and all. Okay. So that is where a CA actually plays a major role. So budding chartered accountants, they have lots and lots of opportunities in finance and financial services sector. And it's great to hear that you were able to get a job within 1 week after you getting result, and that too in core finance, in a profile like equity research analyst, whereas many other chartered accountants who might have qualified in the July examination, they must be preparing their resumes right now. So you already have an offer letter. So that's great to hear. There are many job opportunities when it comes to either a fund accounting, if we consider, or if we consider in various investment funds also, whether be it mutual funds or in this VC funds or private equity funds. And also there are lots and lots of opportunities. And within 5 to 8 years, what happens is the growth is tremendous. There is no other role which actually provides that kind of growth, which is provided in finance and core finance for a chartered accountant. So even though people may start a little slow,
slow.
In 5 to 8 years, they'll be able to grow at a very rapid
exponential rate.
Yeah, at an exponential rate. So lots of opportunities. People have to just focus on their need to understand what opportunities are available. So if they do some research, they'll be able to understand. So good to hear that from you, Ankit. So it's very nice talking to you, and congratulations once again for whatever score you secured and on completing chartered accountancy in your very first go itself, both the groups. And I wish you all the best for your future. I hope that you are going to grow at a very good rate in the next 5 to 10 years. Who knows, maybe you are going to become one of the leading research analysts, and we could be reading some of your reports also within a few years. So all the best for you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Sure, sir. Thanks a lot.